Hi, I'm Mike, your pharmacist. Thank you for joining me on The Daily Dose. Today I will continue my talk on psychosis and schizophrenia. We will cover early detection symptoms of schizophrenia or prodromal psychosis, some of the many probable differential diagnoses. We will quickly cover the basics of substance-induced psychosis. Lastly, we will talk about the symptoms of schizophrenia. These will be discussed in three categories: 1, positive symptoms; 2, negative symptoms; and 3, cognitive symptoms. So first thing we're going to talk about is prodromal psychosis. Before discussing the symptoms of full-blown schizophrenia, I will share some early symptoms of prodromal psychosis, because early detection and intervention can lead to better short and long-term outcomes. Prodromal symptoms are as follows: reduced concentration and attention, reduced drive and motivation, lack of energy, depressed mood, sleep disturbance, anxiety, social withdrawal, deterioration in functioning, irritability. If someone experiences these symptoms, they should seek a professional assessment. Next, we'll be talking about differential diagnoses. In my last video, we talked about the DSM criteria to diagnose schizophrenia, but as I mentioned earlier, mental health is unique to almost every patient. Here is a list of just some differential diagnoses. 1, schizophreniform psychosis, which is similar to schizophrenia except the duration of illness is less than 6 months. There's schizoaffective disorder, which is a combination of concurrent symptoms of schizophrenia and mood disorder. And lastly, substance-induced psychotic disorder. These are delusions or hallucinations that are induced within 1 month of or ingesting drugs or being withdrawn from drugs. Substance-induced psychosis is on the rise with the increase of drug abuse. Many drugs release a sudden surge of feel-good hormone that not only give a euphoric sensation but also motivates individuals. Problem is, street drugs can be highly addictive because once the brain starts to receive an exogenous form of stimulation, it stops producing its own feel-good hormones. The body eventually becomes extremely tolerant to regular doses of drugs and requires more and more to stay functional. Let's take, for example, amphetamines like Ritalin and Adderall. These drugs increase dopamine firing in the mesolimbic pathway. Similarly, the stimulant cocaine blocks the reuptake or the recycling of dopamine. Both types of drug exaggerate dopamine stimulation, which in therapeutic doses and in the short term can increase concentration and motivation. The mesolimbic part of the brain is also known as the reward pathway of the brain. It's responsible for motivation, reinforcement learning, and other cognitive processes. Stimulants like Adderall and cocaine increase focus and motivation, as mentioned earlier, but they also increase risky behaviors. However, too much dopamine in this part of the brain is hypothesized to cause positive symptoms, like delusions or hallucinations. The take-home point here is that the brain is all about balance or homeostasis. If we throw off that balance with an exogenous source, like cocaine, Adderall, they can increase too much dopamine in certain parts of the brain and can be very harmful, leading to symptoms of schizophrenia like psychosis. And this can occur even before the progression to addiction. While on the topic, the mesolimbic pathway also plays a central role in the neurobiology of addiction and depression. In animals, a depletion of dopamine in this pathway increases the extent to which an animal is willing to go to obtain a reward like food or nicotine. In addition, the anticipation of a reward increases dopamine firing as well. It is thought dysregulation in this part of the brain is one of the reasons schizophrenics are more prone to drug abuse and dependence. Self-medication with stimulants like cocaine or amphetamines or opiates like oxycodone helps them better fit into society and better focus on day-to-day tasks. Now let's get back on track and talk about the symptoms of schizophrenia. Symptoms of schizophrenia can be classified into 3 major categories: 1 is positive symptoms, 2 is negative symptoms, and 3 is cognitive symptoms. Positive symptoms are also known as psychotic symptoms. These are behaviors or their experiences that the average person would not have. These symptoms include delusions, hallucinations, disorganized thoughts, disorganized mood, and disorganized behavior. Delusions are fixed or false beliefs that have no basis in fact. Hallucinations. People may hear, see, taste, smell, or feel something that does not actually exist. Disorganized thoughts makes it very hard to communicate with other people. Disorganized mood. They may find it hard to express feelings. Or they may have these intense bursts of emotion. Or at other times, they may feel empty of any emotions at all. Disorganized behavior, they may struggle to complete everyday tasks, such as bathing, dressing appropriately, and preparing simple meals. The second category is negative symptoms. Negative symptoms refers to traits that are absent or reduced in people with schizophrenia. They may have this flat effect, reduced expression or emotions via facial expression or voice tone. They become, 1, socially withdrawn. 2, they lose interest in things they used to care about. There's a reduced pleasure in everyday life and they act unmotivated. 3, they have problems finishing tasks or making long-term plans. 4, there's a loss of interest in the feelings and lives of others. And 5, there's a slowing of physical activity level. And this is a point to ponder because as clinicians, it is easy to recommend physical activity, but it's important to understand the pathogenesis of the brain in schizophrenia to better understand why they may struggle with accepting this recommendation. The third category is cognitive symptoms. This refers to poor executive functioning or the ability to understand information and use it to make decisions. Trouble focusing or paying attention. Problems with working memory. Schizophrenics may not have the ability to use information immediately after learning it as well. Today we touched upon the workings of the brain and how an imbalance in chemicals can lead to 3 classes of symptoms. Next week we will talk about the pathology of the illness in more detail. I thank you for joining me on The Daily Dose. If you found this video informative, please like it.